God's going to be God. I know it's not cold compared to what some, but I know what's coming, you know. I mean, you can tell me all you want. It's not cold, but it's 40s tomorrow. It's going to be bad. Yeah, yeah. But you'll still be sweating. I don't think I'd announce that to everybody, but we'll just let everybody on the internet, Beth will still be sweating. All right. She admitted it. It's a confession for the whole church. No, I almost wore it. I almost wore it, man. I really did. I thought about it. I thought, I don't need to. But you know what? The funny thing is they still played four more games than the Braves did. So I don't know. They may not have played very well, but they played four more games. So they went deeper, man. But hey, that's what it is. Fan is win or lose, right? Win or lose. I'm a fan of God. Let's go back to him. Got to play the game to lose. Yeah, you're already a loser if you're not even in the game. So anyway, tonight we're going to pick up where we left off, looking at the book of Revelation chapter 21. For most that have been here, I don't know if we need to read all of it so much, but I want to go back to this part where we're digging out of, and I say we because you got to go along for the ride with me, but it's what God's at least caught my heart with, and that's taking a look at this combination here of, we've already covered a bunch of 21, but kind of stopped here on this idea of this picture of the wall. Or of the gates, excuse me, the gates, the pearly gates. And Revelation 21, as well as other places, it really is, in my mind, I mean, I can't figure it out, heads or tails, because it seems to intertwine or interchange that the New Jerusalem is the church, and the church is the New Jerusalem, the bride of Christ. And how God's going to do that, I don't know, but I'm just, I know one thing, I'm for it, however he wants to do it. Because his imagination's far greater than mine, his capabilities are far greater than mine. And the picture here he's trying to give us is this one of the love story of Christ to his bride, saying, hey, it's going to be worth it. I've got this plan for you. Don't give up just because it seems like it's taking a long time. Don't give up on me. Don't give up on your faith in me. Don't give up on how grand it's going to be, because when we change it, no matter how well you've had it or how bad you've had it on this earth, it is going to be beyond. It's going to be knock your socks off time. And so we read here in 21, picking up with the paragraph of verse 9, one of the seven angels that had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, come and I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain great and high and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. You see why I get confused. Is this talking about the New Jerusalem, or is this talking about heaven, or is this talking about the bride of Christ? And I would tell all of you, yes. It shone with the brilliance, which was like that of a very precious jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. So although a colored stone, you could see right through it. And it had a great high wall with 12 gates and with 12 angels at the gates. And on the gates were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. Three gates on the east, three on the north, three on the south, three on the west. Last I knew, 3 times 4 is what? 12. All right, so we had three on each one of them. So no matter what direction you came from, and it goes along with other places where God's told us to go out into all the world, and the world's oftentimes pictured as the north, east, south, and west, because if you send vectors out, I mean, it surrounds it and comes right back to it. And so that's the picture that Jesus Christ gave John, that John turned around and shared with us. The part that I've stopped and looked at here was with these 12 tribes of Israel. And why in the world would God take time to put these 12 Israeli tribes on these gates, or a gate to each one of them, or a pearly gate if you want to look at it that way? And the only thing I come away with is the fact that, and that's what we're doing, is going back and looking at Jerusalem. How did this promise, how did this covenant, the old covenant, begin itself? And it's the faith-based covenant of God giving it to his people. And it's, even though this was back in the Old Testament time, it's still valuable for us to understand and to see that God used these 12 tribes because they were a result of what? A promise that he had made to a man. And not only a promise that God made to Abraham, but a contract between the two of them that God said, if you do this, then I will do that. And what he was promising Abraham was, if you'll come to where I show you and go wherever I tell you, I will go ahead and see to it that you are the father of many nations. And we've looked at several of the Old Testament passages, and we looked at the impossibility he and Sarah had. They'd tried like crazy to have kids and still hadn't. Abraham had been following God in this regard, seeking this promised child. And somewhere in the midst of it, I think he began to realize, you know what? Like what many of us, I think we oftentimes come to God. One, we treat him like a spare tire. If we have a flat or a wreck, God, where are you? I need your help. And so we get him out of the trunk and we jack up the car and put the spare on. We go from there. And it's not that God won't be used that way. It's just that he understands he's being used. And for a while, he will let us do that. It's like God, when we're first seeking him, and I think when we first come to him, it's just amazing the most simple of prayers that he will answer. And I'm not going to tell you that as you get deeper with him that he quits answering prayers. It's just that it doesn't seem to be quite so automatic. My presumption is being a kid and still remembering very much being a kid is that after a while, dad, granddad, the people around me, they cut it off, you know, cut off as far as the anything that you ask, I'll do for you, because I was growing up and they didn't want me to be spoiled rotten. And so in the same way, I think God wants us to deepen. But what's he want us to deepen? He wants us to grow up and to do our own thing? No. Still this complete dependency on him, but an interdependency that we begin working with God and God through us. And so what I see that took place was is that Abraham began to follow God because of the promise. Most people I know really come to accept Christ because they don't want to go to hell. I don't know about you, but that's not a bad reason to follow Christ, right? I mean, at least if you believe in hell, and some people don't, and I even know people that don't really believe in it, but just in case there is one, they want to have a fire escape type deal. But, you know, we tend to come to Christ for that, or we come to him in the midst of a great crisis or need. And that's fine with him. In fact, I believe that he allows those things. And like we looked at Jonah, he relents from sending calamity, but he will allow calamity to happen. Why? So that we will cry out to him so that he can deliver us. Not just so that he's the hero, but so that we'll understand his love that's there for us. And the big thing about these 12 tribes is, as we've looked even on Sunday morning with Joseph, these 12 guys, man, they weren't the best boys in the bunch. They weren't just a bunch of good Boy Scouts that did a good deed every day. They had problems. And they were a result of the promise that God gave to Abraham. And we're going to look tonight and see when God finally fulfills that promise. And he has Isaac. Isaac had two sons. And these two sons, again, weren't angels. We've got one that was rough and tough and everything like that. We got the other one that was a mama's boy. But he got the blessing by cheating and deceiving. And then we've got from him then and his wives and even the concubines, we've got then these 12 boys that were born, the 12 tribes of Israel. And although if Abraham would have been alive, what he would have seen was, wow, man, this is really cool. I've got 12 great-great-grandsons. But Abraham had died. But Isaac had 12 grandchildren, 12 grandsons plus the granddaughter. And, you know, but God saw not 12 people. He saw what? Tribes. He saw what was yet going to come. And I'm not trying to make too big a deal out of this. I just want you to understand that God never loses track of the big picture. Now, nor does he lose track of what's going on in your life or my life right now. But that's how God he is. He is quite capable of the intricate moments, but he never loses track of the big picture of your life and all the time creating these variables that will come about so that we intersect with people that he knows we need. We may not even want them, but we need them. And he does that because he knows what's coming up, good or bad. And he knows where he needs me in your life where I can help you, but he also knows where I will need you in my life where you can help me. And it's because that's the way God works. And so these 12 tribes in that are coming about, and the reason I think that they're listed here on these each of these gates, what do you do with gates? You go in or you go out, don't you? It's the way you access whatever's on the other side of the wall. If there is no gate, there's no way in. And so he chose then to give and to symbolize these gateways that come in. And although we know Jesus even said of himself, I am the gate, but he didn't go ahead and put Jesus on each one of these. He put these 12 tribes. And the curiosity in me began to look, and what I began to see then with the Old Testament fulfillment and as it went along was God was showing the gates, the openings into the presence of God come about through his promise. And for people that will receive his promise and like Abraham, meet him where he's at, God says, great, now you can come in and be with me. If you read earlier in chapter 21, that's what he says. Now the presence of God is with men. I'll be with them. They'll be with me. It's this picture of the with thing going on. Now, I started to say earlier, Abraham started out wanting just to get the promise. But there's one thing said about Abraham that I'm not, I almost can say 100%, but I'm not willing to go that far. But as a whole, that nothing else was ever said about anybody else, and that was that Abraham was known as a friend of God. I don't know about you, but that's a pretty big attainment, right? That's getting somewhere when you become a friend of God. What that tells me is that although Abraham responded to God because he believed, he had faith, and he believed that God would do what he said he would do, in this process of this journey and this walk, that tonight we're going to get to 24 years of this walking and going wherever God led him, 25 years before Isaac is born. But in the midst of this walk, Abraham began to understand that what God was really looking for wasn't just to be sugar daddy in the sky and you bow down and worship me and I'll give you stuff. God was really wanting a friend. And he really wanted to have a loving relationship. And it's no different with us. We may come to him because we don't want to go to hell. But as we walk with him, truly walk with him, we'll begin to enjoy him and understand, wait a minute, even the walk, even when things aren't going right, when the presence of God is there, it can go ahead and hold us together to be able to experience the next victory that we might see, even in the midst of what seems to be defeat right now. And so this story, I believe, and the reason of the 12 pearls and the 12 gates and the 12 tribes, I really think it was God saying, it's not about your perfection. I just want your attention. And it's not that he wants us so we applaud him. It's just he wants us to know how much he loves us, and he just hopes that we'll respond back in true love back to him, that response. And so the gate becomes much more than just entering. It's entering in to become a part of what all God's got, if you will. Let's pray. God, far be it from me, intelligence-wise or even as an orator, to be able to speak the right words and everything that way. And yet, because of these 12 tribes, God, I believe you'll use even me. And God, that you do truly cross our paths with people, that one way or another, that sometimes we need each other, sometimes we don't even recognize what the person brought to us, and sometimes the people don't treat us the way that we think that we ought to be, but God, it doesn't lessen anything about who you are. And ultimately, you want us to begin to be those people on this earth that others that can't see you in faith begin to see us, or see you and us in flesh, that they begin to recognize that there's something about us that's different. And it's not just our optimism, and it's not just that we always whistle or we always have, you know, upbeat. It's not that we never experience any hardship or hurt times. It's just that we never allow ourselves to get down because we believe that you are still working all things to good if we just keep loving you. So God, tonight I pray out of your love that you would speak through me. And I don't mean just that so that I can speak so many minutes of a sermon. But what I really mean is that you'll speak through me. That those that are here tonight, those that are listening in, those that might listen in again or in the future, that God, that what they'll hear is something that they needed, whether it's in reassurance, whether it's in just understanding and knowledge, that sometimes we need to be able to put other things together, whether it's, Lord, even in correction or whether it's just in your loving way, that God, that your voice is what will be heard, your presence will be felt, and there would be a desire from each one of us here tonight, Lord, to just want to kind of snuggle up next to you, to come in close, to be your friend, and to let you be our God. Not reigning over us in the way that some dictator would. No, by choosing as we submit to you, you protect us. You reign over us in that regard. You may point and show us direction to go, but even then, it's always going to be for our best as well as yours and the kingdom. So God, tonight, speak through me, but speak to me as well. As you know, I still need your direction too. And I give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. So from here, we've looked back here in the book of Genesis. If you will, let's go back. We left off with chapter 17. And so we started with the beginning with God and Abraham and how that all started out. And we've slowly, some of you would say almost slow, as we went through Revelation, we've been going through this. But what I want you to see here in 17 then, where we left off last week, was God asked Abraham to up the ante. And he said, okay, so you followed me now where I said to go. Now I'm going to recommit my promise to you. You're going to have a child, and this child is going to have many children that will have be kings and various things and all this stuff. And even gave him the prophecy that they would go to Egypt. He didn't say it at the time, but that they would be in exile. They would be in bondage for 400 years. So God said all this before it ever happened, a long time before it ever happened. And what we read here then, if you will, we'll just pick up here in verse 19 or verse 15. God also said to Abraham, so it's Genesis 17, 15, as for Sarai, your wife, you're no longer call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. And what that seemed to mean was one meant just a mom and one meant the mother of many. I will bless her. I'll surely give you a son by her. I'll bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her, meaning various nations even from that. Abraham fell face down, and this just cracks me up. I mean, I think it's so hilarious, and it's a great, great passage. He fell face down. What'd he do? He laughed. And he said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old, and will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? 90. And Abraham said to God, if only Ishmael might live under your blessing. He's saying, man, Israel's already here. If only that would be. But God, man, that's just so far-fetched. But I think that it's great, because what do friends do when they're together with each other? Well, man, my friends, I like to laugh. You know, I think it's a shame when we quit. I think that's one of the biggest things in marriages that sometimes happens is we forget how to laugh. And we get so conscientious about, you know, being offended that sometimes we don't know how to laugh with each other, let alone at each other. And come on, folks, I mean, it's the aquarium. We're pretty funny looking sometimes, and we do some pretty funny stuff. And so we as well enjoy each other and laugh. Well, have you ever laughed with God when he told you you could do something or wanted you to do this or that, and you're going, there ain't no way, God, that that's going to happen? He goes, not if you got that attitude, but if you want to do it with me, it can happen, because nothing's impossible for God. I love this because I see Abraham laughing, and he doesn't hide it. It's just, oh, come on, God, you have got to be kidding. I've been waiting 24 years, and now you're going, but now it's close. But it's right after he just told him he's going to be circumcised too. And so that's what's amazing about this whole thing. But God said, man, you are going to have a son. And so God said, yes, but your wife Sarah will bear you a son. You'll call him Isaac. I'll establish my covenant with him, an everlasting covenant, covenant for descendants after him. For Ishmael, I have heard you. Now, you see what friends do? They listen, even sometimes when it seems like we're not. And again, husbands and wives, that's always a good thing, too, to listen, right? I have heard you, and I'll surely bless him. I'll make him fruitful and greatly increase his numbers. He'll be the father of, ironically, 12 rulers, and I'll make him into a great nation. But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you by this time next year. So within a year, by this time next year, you're going to have a baby in your arms. And when he had finished speaking with Abraham, God went up from him. On that very day, Abraham took his son Ishmael and all those born in the household or bought with money, every male in his household, and circumcised them as God told him. Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised, and his son Ishmael was 13. Abraham and his son Ishmael were both circumcised. You get the idea? I mean, it's like, boy, do we have to really repeat this over and over again? But yep, I don't know why, other than to make sure, because, I mean, if it's happening to you, you'd go, holy smokes, man. Yep, we really did it. They were circumcised on the same day, and every male in Abraham's household, including those born in the household or bought from a foreigner, was circumcised with him. So the Lord appeared to Abraham, and we go on and read about this appearance, and to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre. When he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day, so it's hot as can be out, he's in the heat of the day, so he's doing the smart thing. He's sitting at the tent and letting the all of his rest of his personnel take care of the livestock and everything. But Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. So I don't know whether he'd been taking a nap and looked up, or I don't know if he just kind of lollygagging. All that's like, wait, where'd those three guys come from? Those aren't my normal guys. He looked up. He saw three men standing nearby. And when he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them. Now, the guy's 99 years old. So I don't know how he hurried, whether it was this was hurrying, you know, or what. Or I mean, I really think that he was still pretty spry. So he probably just took off and went out and ran up to them. He hurried over to them from the entrance of his tent, and he met them. And then what'd he do? He's limber enough he could bow down before them. Now, I don't know how much time had gone between the circumcision and this, so I can't really speak about that. But he bowed down, so things must have been a little bit better. He said, if I found favor in your eyes, my Lord. So there's something about these three men, or one of them at least, that caught his attention, and I can't begin to explain to you what, other than I know that there's those weird times when suddenly the hair will stand up on the back of my neck. One, it can do it out of fear, and the other can do it out of awesomeness, right? And sometimes it's just that awareness that, wow, God is here. But nonetheless, in this particular case, so he recognized and he goes, man, and he bowed down to him. And he said, if I found favor in your eyes, my Lord, don't pass your servant by. In other words, can you hang around for a while? Let a little water be brought. Then you may all wash your feet. And you can just rest underneath this tree. We've got a nice shade tree going on here, this tree at Mamre. He said, let's just do that. Let me get you something to eat so you can be refreshed and then go on your way now that you've come to your servant. Now, there's one thing out of this, and I know this isn't Old Testament history, and you didn't do this, you didn't come tonight for Revelation to go just look and have a full study of Genesis. But I think that within these passages, it's important. We can read them and then just ignore them, but within it, I mean, like it's stressed, the relationship. But at the same time, we have difficulty understanding God, don't we? Because why? We're human. Even though Jesus got in a human body, he had 12 guys around him, they still had trouble understanding him sometimes, right? I mean, sometimes what he said, oftentimes what he did, other times, holy smokes, you are really the Son of God, man. Because they would get used to him in his flesh being like them, but then he would pull off a stunt that suddenly is like, oh man, you're not just Jesus, you're the Son of God. You know, it's so clear. In this particular case here, Abraham's relating to these three men. He knows that they're not from the area. He gets the idea real quick and the bowing down and everything. They're from God and of God. And I think he even senses a little bit more than that. But yet he treats him like a human. I'm not finding fault with Abraham. I'm just saying it's so funny. But don't you want something to eat and this and this and this? And man, I mean, I'm guessing they just kind of dropped in out of heaven. So they're probably really not too hungry. But Abraham listened to him. And they listened to Abraham. And very well, they said, do as you say. So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. Just like a good husband would do. Hurry up, man. His problem now has become her problem. She didn't invite him. He invited him. He said, get 3 seahs of fine flour, knead it, and bake some bread. Man, it's not like going to the pantry and just pulling out the bread loaf. I mean, it's not even like going to the freezer and trying to thaw one of those other loaves out. This is starting from scratch, man. And it's like, what? I mean, you just got to sometimes kind of get into this what was really happening here, because they didn't have microwaves, you know? So she goes to bake some bread. Then he ran to the herd, ran. This 99-year-old guy running out there to the herd, selected a choice, tender calf. We call it what? Veal. Veal. Going to get a choice, tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. In other words, to kill it and strip it and get the meat and all this stuff. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under the tree. So I think that this is kind of one of those Jesus moments when it's not Jesus of Nazareth in the flesh, but it's Jesus still in a human-looking body, but he's not, and a couple of angels that are side by side with him. And he waits. But I'm just trying to be practical here. You know, I'm not a real good waiter. I did a good job when I was a busboy and that kind of waiter, but I'm not a good waiter, you know. Patient waiter, are you? You know, I mean, 15 minutes about all the time I'll wait, you know, and it's like, okay, let's go on. And what's that? No, they're making bread, yeah. So, I mean, we're talking hours. We're talking about butchering a calf. We're talking about draining the blood. We're talking about all this stuff and then doing it. Now, the one thing that probably was they had on hand because they had so many sheep and goats and stuff was these curds. They had the cottage cheese ready, but it wasn't cold, you know. I'm just not really sure about lumpy hot milk. But nonetheless, anyway, so They waited, and then they ate. And they said, I mean, just trying to teach you how to read the Bible. I mean, you got to ask these questions in there sometimes and go, whoa, man, that wasn't just easy. So then they ask him while they were eating or after they ate. He said, where's your wife, Sarah? They're in the tent. I can just kind of hear him say, Moses, in the tent. Where all good women belong, you know. I don't know if he had that kind of voice or not, you know, but she's in the tent. I mean, I'd at least been smart enough to say, well, who do you think made the bread, dude? You know, but the Lord said, I'll surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Now get this. So, I mean, here's all this hurrying and scurrying, and, I mean, a 99-year-old man running around like a chicken with his head cut off, trying to cut the head off the cow and get the already and everything like that, because he wants to take good care of these people. I don't know if he was hands-on involved with everything. We know he picked, but he turned over to a servant and this and that. But I got a feeling he probably was, just because he wanted everything to be right. And so he's trying to make this real elegant picnic lunch out here under the tree at Mamre, and Sarah's doing her deal with the bread and everything like that. And he comes over, and then they say, well, where is Sarah? And it's like, is that what you came to talk about, Sarah? I thought you were here to see me, man. Typical guy. I just thought you were here to see me, but you want to see her? But then God says, because I want to tell you, I told you how long ago? 24 years ago. I told you 24 years ago this had happened. I'm narrowing it down a little bit. I know it's not been easy. I know you grew impatient. 24 years, that's a long time, isn't it? A real long time to wait on a promise. I mean, kids have trouble waiting for Christmas and birthdays, you know, but 24 years to wait for a promise. And now all of a sudden God goes and he drops the bomb. He said, about this time next year, you're going to have a son. Abraham already done the laugh. Well, it's Sarah's turn this time because, like a good wife, she's eavesdropping. Sarah was listening at the entrance of the tent. I mean, it's like, you know, she's just... And how old is she? 90. She's 90. So maybe her hearing went so good. Maybe she's halfway out. She thought she was hiding, you know. I don't know. But she's listening at the entrance of the tent, which was behind him. And Abraham and Sarah were already old and well advanced in years. And Sarah was past the age of childbearing. What's that mean? She'd gone through the change. Man, when you get before you get married, they don't tell you about the change. It's because they can't explain it. But the change changes all kinds of things. The household is disrupted. Air conditioner up and down, you know, so the change. Anyway, Sarah was past the age of childbearing. I guess at 90, you'd think so, right? So Sarah, what'd she do? She laughed to herself. I think she's over there. I mean, my picture of it, if I was doing the movie, she's over there. And she's still a pretty hot 90-year-old chick, but she's over there. And she's drinking some curds and whey. And I think she spit out milk. I think she... Because I just have to believe that somewhere along the line, Sarah's going, Abraham, look, man, I hung in there with you, honey. I tried to prove I love you. I went along with all this. We left home and civilization to go out here and to live like these crazy nomad shepherds and fought battles and tried to bring Lot along. And I've gone through all this stuff. And you kept saying, but you're going to have a baby. You're going to have a baby. You're going to have a baby. And I still don't have a baby. And now God says, oh, yeah, you're going to have one by this time next year. Yeah, 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 right. So she laughed and says to herself, but usually that has, like I said, you either spit up or you make that funny noise or whatever. And then notice what she says, because this isn't me writing this. This is in the Bible. After I'm worn out, not my words, hers. I just really don't have a lot to say about that. She's worn out. I'll just leave it at that. After I'm worn out and my master is old, will I now have, and she did throw this in, this pleasure. Are you kidding me? After all this, and it's impossible. Come on, God. We had a shot at it back when I was 75, but now, I mean, there ain't no way. You know, it's just, but I'm going to have this pleasure. And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, will I really have a child now? God doesn't have a problem hearing. He hears things, because everything we say is like a prayer to God. Might just make that mental note. Even when we think we're talking to somebody else or about somebody else, God still hears. And God asked Abraham, he said, why'd Sarah laugh and say, will I really have a child now that I'm old? And then the Lord says, is anything really too hard for me? I'll return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Like the famous words of Arnold Schwarzenegger, I'll be back. I'll be back, and you were going to have a baby. And Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, I didn't laugh. But he said, yes, you did laugh. Now, I wonder if she's in there, you know, because like I said, she's trying to be stealth over here and just eavesdropping, and then she laughs, and that kind of gives it away. And then Abraham goes, why did she laugh? And apparently somewhere in the mission, I didn't laugh, not me, no, it wasn't me, it was somebody else. You know, I don't know. Wouldn't you like me to do church movies? I just think it'd be great, man. I'd bring the Bible to life. Okay. But he said, yes, you did laugh. What's Isaac's name mean? Laughter. Why? Because mom and dad both laughed at the thought that this is finally going to happen. And God didn't have any problem laughing with them and doing the old Larry the Cable Guy, watch this. All right, so after 17 then, let's go over to, or we did 18 there, I guess it was. And from 18, let's go on to 20. And I want to do 20. I was going to skip over it because 21 jumps into the birth of Isaac, but I think that this 20, while we're here, you know, taking the time, I think chapter 20 is pretty cool. And if you've got your Bibles and you don't mind writing in them, which I do all the time, I don't write in yours, I just write in mine, but You might want to put Genesis 12 up there, because it's a parallel passage with Genesis 20. And what the deal is it's really flattering Abraham to his wife, because he thinks she's hot. And that's always nice for a wife, you know, for her husband to think she's hot. Unless she's going through the change, that's a different kind of hot altogether, you know. But he thinks she's hot. And so as they go out on this voyage together, he said to her, he said, "Now look, I don't know where all we're going to end up, but do me a favor, because I'd like to live. And if you will, and we meet somebody in there, you know, it can be a life or death situation really quick. So you're better off telling them that you're my sister than you are that you're my wife. Because they'll keep a brother around, they'll kill off a husband, you know." So that was the thought. And so they did this with the king of Egypt, or at the time, when they went down there. And they're about to do it again here. And the reason that I say that I think it's important to look at this is because we forget. I think it's important to understand that these 12 tribes, the 12 gates that let you go into heaven in the presence of God, that are based off the promise, just like he gave to Abraham, which became then to his great-grandsons. Even though Abraham was a father of faith and had great faith, and even though he was a good man, a friend of God, he still had his struggles. And there's two kinds of struggles. There's sometimes a struggle in, do you really believe? And he seemed to hold on to that, but he didn't take it as far as he could have. And here's just the logical thing about it, and I think we're the same way. We have a tendency to trust that, okay, one of these days I'm going to die. I know I will. I won't be able to prevent that. And I believe that God's going to take me to heaven because of Jesus Christ, and Jesus and I are good, so that's going to make it good, and I'll get in. But I think we trust God with our eternal life, but I don't think we always trust him very much with our current life. And when I say that, I don't mean we don't trust him at all. It's just that we have a tendency to just go a little ways, and then we stop. And somehow or another, a part of it becomes in this thing of where we pull onto ourselves through our anxiety, through our worry, through our concern, through our thoughts, and how in the world am I going to get out of this or into this or do that or whatever it would be. And if we're not careful, we do it on our own instead of doing it not only in the presence of God, but with the presence of God. Instead of God just being God, he wants to be what? Our friend. Not because he's less God, but I mean, he wants a relationship. And in that relationship, he wants us to trust him with everything that we have no control over. Because we should believe that he has a purpose for each and every one of us. And in that purpose, he, no matter how impossible it may seem, can bring it about, just as he was going to hear. But what we read here, and back in chapter 12 in both situations, is we read Abraham's shaky faith. On, he believed that God would give him a child, but he didn't understand, if I'm going to believe that, then God's got to keep me alive. And so he took it upon himself to try to be a little bit deceptive to keep himself alive. And so he tells Sarah to just say, "You're my sister." And the weird kind of cruddy thing is, but it's normal in the South, I guess, is that she was. So, but they had different moms, but same dad, you know. So back then, I guess that was okay, just like it is down here. Anyway, now Abraham moved on from there into the region of the Negev. We didn't do cousins, man. We just, yeah. Now Abraham, okay, I'm getting myself done. Abraham moved on from there into the region of the Negev and lived between Kadesh and Shur. For a while he stayed in Gerar, and there Abraham said to his wife Sarah, or said of his wife Sarah, "She's my sister." Abimelech, the king of Gerar, said for Sarah, or sent for Sarah, excuse me, and took her. So Abraham said this, he just kind of like volunteered, "Oh, did you want to meet my sister Sarah?" And so, hey, she's 90 years old, going on 91, and she's still good looking, enough that this king goes, "Wow, man." Even though her own estimation was, what, "I'm worn out," you know, but the package looks good. And I'm not making this up. I mean, that's what's involved with this, and that's just hard to imagine. I mean, but I think she probably was still a pretty good-looking woman at 90, all right? So he sent for Sarah and took her. What's that mean? Well, he sends his dignitaries and the maids and everything in and brings her into his harem, so to speak. I mean, it's like, hey, you know, I'm a king. That's what kings do. But God came to Abimelech in a dream one night. What a name, right? Abimelech. It reminds me of that one old song back in the 60s. I don't know why, but Abimelech, the king of Gerar, sent for Sarah, took her. God came to Abimelech in a dream. And I don't know, Abimelech just sounds like they would go with that song. One night and said to him, now get this, man, because this is a real curious type thing. And, you know, doctrinally, man, it scrambles my mind. But God, we know, speaks to those that are his, but he speaks to even those that really aren't his. And so he gives this dream to this Abimelech in the middle of the night. And he said to him, you're as good as dead because of the woman you've taken. She is a married woman. Now, Abimelech had not gone near her, so he said, Lord, will you destroy an innocent nation? He understood not only was he dead, but his whole kingdom was about to be wiped out. And this guy takes this dream serious, and it's just like dry mouth, everything else. Like they said, Lord, how did he know it was the Lord? Some things you just know. And you're as good as dead, got his attention. He said, did he not say to me, she's my sister? And didn't she also say, he's my brother? I have done this with a clear conscience and clean hands. And so really, yeah, I mean, he'd been deceived, hadn't he? And so what his response is that, whoa, God, man, I mean, I am sorry can be, but this wasn't a plot or a plan of mine. I'm not trying to cheat on anybody here. And God said to him in his dream, yes, and this is a pretty, explicit dream, right? Yes, I know you did this with a clear conscience, so I have kept you from sinning. Now, I don't know why, but I circled that because that's intriguing to me. I have kept you from sinning against me. Again, I don't know how far to take that. And I'm not saying, obviously, God doesn't do that because I think all of us have experienced sin. But maybe there are times, and I don't know if you've ever found yourself hitting that invisible wall, and it's God really in his grace saying, I'll not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But I've kept you from sinning against me. That's why I did not let you even touch her. Now return the man's wife. And this is also curious to me. For he is a prophet, one who speaks for God. And he will pray for you, and you'll live. But if you don't return her, you may be sure that you and all of yours will die. I mean, that's what I call a nightmare, not a dream. How about you? You know, I mean, that's freaky scary, right? So early the next morning, Abimelech summoned all of his officials, and he told them all that had happened. He said, I had this dream, man. And they, too, were very much afraid. They read between the lines and go, we aren't going to mess with this. Then Abimelech called Abraham, and he said, what have you done to us? Not just to me, but to us. How have I wronged you that you brought such great guilt upon me and my kingdom? You've done things to me that should not have been done. In other words, you've broken the code, man. This isn't right. And Abimelech asked Abraham, what was your reason for doing this? And that's another thing that's worth underlining. And what would happen if we'd only ask ourselves before we do something, what would be my reason for what I'm about to do? Abraham replied, I said to myself, so he's telling him, he said, yeah, I just said to myself, there is surely no fear of God in this place. Well, he misjudged that, didn't he? And they will kill me because of my wife. Besides, she really is my sister, the daughter of my father, though not my mother, and she became my wife. And when God had me wander from my father's household, I said to her, this is how you can show your love to me. Everywhere we go, say of me, he's my brother. So in Abraham's mind, that was just being smart. But sometimes we can outsmart faithfulness. And which is better in the long run? Being smart or being faithful? The smartest thing you can do is be faithful to God, because what? He'll be faithful to you. Like he told Sarah, is there anything that's too impossible for me? But sometimes we think God needs our help. Sometimes when we're thinking that, we're wanting to help him with the things that he can handle himself, and we're not doing the things that we need to do, that we're responsible. So anyway, verse 14, Abimelech brought sheep and cattle, male and female slaves, and gave them to Abraham, and he returned Sarah, his wife, to him. And Abimelech said, my land is before you. Live wherever you like. To Sarah he said, I'm giving your brother 1,000 shekels of silver. This is to cover the offense against you before all who are with you. You are completely vindicated. And Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech. Now, see, this takes a little bit farther. God healed Abimelech, his wife, his slave girl, so that they could not have, he healed them so they could, because at this point in time, the Lord had closed up every womb in Abimelech's household because of Abraham's wife, Sarah. Now, so, like I said, it's an interesting and strange chapter, but I think it really does reflect what happens when we try to outthink faithfulness and we don't just trust that God's got this handled. I also believe that this passage deals with something that's, like I said, amazing, that he kept this man from sinning, and he closed up the place with flesh, or closed up their wombs, so to speak, so they could not conceive and have children. And don't you wonder why? It's because he wanted one thing to happen, and that one thing was he wanted his promise to be fulfilled exactly like he'd promised Abraham and Sarah, the two of them. Not Abraham and Sarah's handmaid, not Abimelech, any chance of Abimelech and having that deal where they can't even do a DNA test and go, well, whose child is it really? God wanted them to know, no, this is my deal between the two of you, Mr. 99 and Mrs. 90. This is my deal between the two of you, and I'm telling you, I'm going to honor my word and I'm going to fulfill my promise. And you will have from your own bodies come about a child, and that child will become the many that I promised you would happen. And I share that with you because, again, I want, you know, we're not all as clear, and we don't all have clear dreams, but I think sometimes we're not really aware of what God's purpose is for us. The scriptures give us some, and we've got some of the same overlapping purposes. But the sad thing is, so oftentimes what we do while we're waiting on trying to discover the purpose, we fail to do any kind of purposeful thing. And man, you can always do the generics, loving your enemies, praying for those that, you know, you don't like, and one thing and another like that. We can always do those things. We can all give. We can all witness. We can all do one thing and another like that as we try to discover what is our purpose. I've told most all of you that I don't know altogether what my whole purpose is. I know that a part of it was preaching, but I'm not dumb enough to believe that that's all that is, so I quit looking. At the same time, I don't get up every morning going, God, I just wish I knew what my purpose was. It's like, I'm going to continue to do what I'm doing, and if you open doors, God, you'll open the doors and you'll make sure that I don't miss them. But one of the reasons that I don't fear dying is not because I don't think I'll die. It's just, I don't think I'll die till I fulfilled my purpose. What do you think? Not about me, but about you. Do you believe that God can keep you alive until you've fulfilled your purpose? And if so, doesn't that answer a bunch of questions? And so every time we go, oh, I don't know how I'm going to ever do this, man. Usually it's because we're thinking about us instead of about God. And man, he wanted this couple that had waited what will eventually be 25 years, they have waited. He wanted this couple to know that they knew this happened as an act of God. He could have snapped his fingers and made Sarah pregnant. He didn't want that. He wanted to be from Abraham's physical body and Sarah's physical body, a union, an egg and a sperm that would unite and form a life that would be a boy named Isaac. And guess what happened? God wasn't prohibited. Abimelech almost got in the way, but even there, what did God do? He stuck his hand in there and said no in such a strong way that this guy that Abraham presumed was ungodly suddenly got very godly, and he not only said, I'm sorry, but turned around and, I mean, 1,000 shekels? I mean, they only paid 20 for Joseph when they sold him as a slave. So that's a whole bunch of shekels there, you know? But he gave it to him. Why? Because he not only didn't want anything to happen, but on top of that, saying, man, I am sorry. I am really sorry. I want to bless you. Now, that's the other thing that's really interesting throughout Scripture, and I think sometimes we get in the way of being blessed because we keep trying to get blessed. And that may not be really even good English, but I hope that the thought will be something you can entertain for a while. I really do believe that sometimes we fail to receive the blessing because we're trying to get a blessing. What God did here is he blessed, but it wasn't because Abraham asked for anything. And it's just amazing how many different ways God was providing. And
what I think that sometimes happens, at least it's happened in my life, and I'm just going to guess that we're enough alike. That's why we're in the same church together. But I think sometimes we miss seeing the blessings of God because we think that we did it. And we fail to include what happens just because of God's deep love for us and his plan for our purpose. I told Karen Rogers today, I had an idea for a shirt, and because she's got one about purpose. And I told her, I said, well, I think I've got an idea for one, and that is repentance leads to repurpose. When we realize that either we're not walking right, and whether it's altogether or just an area, and we repent from it, God now will repurpose us. It's going to be just as if we'd never sinned. And he will bring us in line with his plan for our life. I mean, you got to back up here. And from heaven's view, God had this plan all along. One of God's or Jesus' own disciples wrote to God, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is just like a day. So how long were 25 years? Just a brief moment. But for Abraham and Sarah, waiting for something, a promise, that's a heck of a long time in it to wait. And I'm not making fun of them and their waiting. I just want to encourage any of you that are waiting for something, is don't give up on God. Especially if what you're waiting on is for something that he's already promised you he would do. But again, it's real easy, I found, to be disillusioned because I'm looking for God to bless me doing this, and that wasn't even in his plan, and I missed what he's trying to do over here. But as I said on Sunday morning a couple weeks ago, God is arranging this chessboard so that everybody will be in the right place at the right time. And for some of us, I don't really think that we'll fully comprehend our purpose till we're able to get to heaven and look back and go, oh, that's what he was doing there. And I mean, we've all heard the, you know, it's so worn out, it's cliche, the footprints thing, right? Where were you, God? And I like the one where it was butt prints in the sand instead of footprints. And it was, that's where I tossed your lazy butt because you wouldn't do anything I wanted you to do, you know. So I just left you there for a while. And but I want to encourage you with this, man. It's like at the same time God is putting people in your life to both bless you but to lead you to this point that he wants you, God is using you and other people's lives to get them to this point where he wants them and needs them and they need to be able to be fulfilling and fulfilled. I mean, and that's just this unbelievable thing, and that's what faith does. That's why Jesus said, unless you have faith like a, well, he said mustard seed, but in another place he said like a child. So I'm sorry you couldn't read my mind, but no, the mustard seed faith, he said that's all it takes, but unless you have faith like a child, you'll have no part of me. And what's the one thing that children do? Imagine things. And one of the things I think that keeps our faith from being more prolific is we've lost our imagination. We want everything spelled out, and we think we've got the agenda, and God, what you need to do is this, this, and this for me, and I'll be happy. And God goes, no, you won't. I know I would. No, you won't. Yes, I will. No, you won't. Because if you have this, this, and this, there's still going to be something empty in here. But if you let go of these things and you have me, not only is this fulfilled, but you will have a life that you'll look back on and go, thanks for using me. Because you see, God isn't like the other gods you can bow down to. God doesn't use you in a way that he uses you up and wears you out. God uses you to make you more valuable. So, Brooke, you were right. I didn't get that far. I gave her some extra credit passages I thought I would get to, but I didn't. Hopefully, it wasn't boring for you. And I'm not talking about anything other than the thoughts. Because like I try to say every Sunday, man, I want thinkers. I don't want you coming in here, me telling you what to think. I want you to come in and with this wide open, imaginary, childlike mind and say, God, don't let me miss what you're telling me. And there may be parts out of all this sermon that you can get, but there surely was a part that you were supposed to get. And in the midst of that, I hope that a part of that too is when you get that part from God, you'll not only smile, but you can laugh. Because who but God could have the imagination that he's got? And right now we think that what we're going through, oh man, this is, you know, not good. God's going, hang in there just a second. His seconds are long, but just a second, I've got the plan for you. And when you die and you're able to look back and see how it all fits, you're going to go, why did I even resist? Why did Abraham think he had to protect himself when God was quite capable of doing it? And he did, even with Abimelech. So communion tonight, we offer it each week, primarily due to the fact that Jesus said, as often as you meet, do this in remembrance of me. And we, several of us got to looking and said, man, why don't we offer it on Wednesday night? Is it a Sunday morning only thing? No. And so it's available to any of you that believe, that want to, but not forced on anybody. So if you don't want, just, you know, wave off or pass it on to somebody next to you, okay? Father and God, tonight, just bow before you. And God, I pray sometimes that we allow our jaws to drop in awe-inspired nature of you. Your imagination, your patience, your humor, your love, your plan, and your capabilities. And the most amazing thing to me is you did all this stuff with Abraham and Sarah so that Jesus, you could come. And then instead of just being an earthly king that would reign and be able to take soldiers that would fight the battle and give them life instantly as soon as they were killed, you'd resurrect them and set up this kingdom on earth. You said, no, man, I'm not going to stop there. I want a heavenly kingdom, one that has gates that are pearls. Pearls you can see through. Pearls that have the 12 tribes on, because you are the God of your promises. And you use faulty, fallible people that won't let go. And God, I pray that we're those tonight, that we won't let go. We've screwed up, we've messed up, we've given in and not held out when we should have. When you held out on things from you that we shouldn't have. No, we're not. That's a fairy tale. And I just thank you for places in the Word where it shows that you're able to understand our weaknesses, but you really want us to learn that you are our strength. And if we'll just trust you, that there's no limit to how you can use each one of us. I ask your blessing on my brothers and sisters here tonight, God. I ask your blessing on this communion, that God, that it really would be us, you know, participating in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ and being a part of the body of Christ. For all our scars, all our